thing of it is that the Lord has come to teach us how to be something different than what we were born as. And, you know, you might not understand just how important this is, because all your contrast and comparisons has to do with people who've been taught to live in a demonic realm. And in that demonic realm, there's certain behaviors that, you know, are seemingly good, and they are good. Most people throw friendships and relationships away like they were old clothing, though. So it's only good for a little while. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, you say, well, is everything bad in the human realm? Well, most everything is bad in the human realm because it just doesn't last. I mean, if people had love relationships, we have kind of love relationships, but if people had love relationships like Father described them and once intended them to be, it would go on forever. Everybody would never have a problem with each other. And if there, you know, there would be enough mercy and forgiveness to handle whatever problem. You know what I'm saying? So see, the Lord has come, the Holy Ghost has come to teach us how to live purely divinely. He's come to teach us how to live the way that God intended us to live when he shaped man in his own image, in his likeness. And that is going to be persecuted by the human realm. And it's going to also, even more so, be persecuted by the demonic realm. And the prince of the power of the air, the god of this world that now, right now, works in the children of disobedience, has a very powerful sway upon the mind and attitudes of most human beings, of most men. And even many of God's people, we know that the prince and the power of the atmosphere. What creates the atmosphere? You say, oh, well, we went over there and the atmosphere was terrible. People were just all upset with one another. Oh, we went over to that other place and the atmosphere was wonderful. They was just, everybody was having a good time. I'm talking about an atmosphere that is even bigger in effect and may not be as obvious. Bigger in effect, though, because it affects your attitudes. Bigger in effect because it affects your mind, the way you think, the way you process, the way that you perceive things in the world. Everybody thinks that their perceptions are accurate until they take a test. Then they find out better. And that's a perception based upon what men taught them or what they observed within the framework of that which they were supposed to be looking for. But there is a perception and there is a reality and there is a truth that only the Holy Ghost can make real. He comes and makes real to us the very presence of the living God. He comes and makes real to us the things that belong to God and teaches us and transmits to us everything that is of God that belongs to the Lord Jesus. Now, I want to grab a hold of your attention here this morning. I want to grab a hold of you and I want to take you someplace that you should want to go. You should decide that you should not any longer want to live as mere men. With your attitudes, I'm just telling you right now. I just go like this, with the depth of love that you know. Because God, the Holy Ghost, wants to teach you a deeper love. But he's not going to do it unless you're hungry for it, unless you're passionate for it, unless you really want these things. He wants to teach you a deeper joy. But it's going to be foolishness to the world. He wants to teach you a deeper peace. The world's not going to be able to even comprehend it around you. And this is really problematic because we want to be accepted. We want to be liked. We want to fit in. We don't want to fit out. We want to fit in. We don't want to be the oddball, the awkward person. But everything about the anointing is a reproach and rejected by humanity. I'm going to show you this. I mean, just imagine being Mary. Just imagine having the angel Gabriel come to you and say, you're pregnant. And you're pregnant by God. Good luck convincing everyone. In a town where everybody knows what you ate for breakfast because it's a small Jewish community in Nazareth. Everybody knows everything. They know what time you wake up in the morning, what time you go to the bed. It's an extended family. That's the way it was. An extended family it was intolerable for you to do anything that looked like fornication, that looked like having a baby outside of marriage. In fact, it was demanded by God that they stone such a person. That's how intolerable it was. You may say, well, you know, that just isn't fair. Whatever you want to say within the framework of what you understand about your partial judgments and the way that your culture and your society is imposed upon you, the process by which you deduct and reason and think. Somebody said, oh, I'm a free thinker. You're not a free. I've never met one. I've never been out in the jungle and found somebody who was raised by the wolves, a free thinker. And that person was taught something by the wolves and by the animals and by the environment. Men have the process of thinking and the way that they behave imposed upon them by a society, by a culture. Go to a caste system. Go to a strict caste system in India and look at the different way of thinking. Go to a strict caste system in a Bedouin community in Saudi Arabia. You can't even relate. Go to Minya, Egypt. You won't even, it's like going back 2,000 years ago. You won't even be able to relate to the people. And it suddenly begins to open up your eyes. Wait a minute. Is what I think, is what I believe, is the things that the way that I perceive the world, is it really that accurate? Go to Irian Jaya in Indonesia. I mean, they found people still living like what they perceive cavemen to be, you know, back in just about 15 years ago. So all of these perceptions of ours that we value so highly and that we think so much about, and all of these particular preferences that we have, are actually imposed upon us. Are you listening to me? Yes. Does it sound very terrible to think about being a cannibal and eating someone? Well, not to the Irian giants. That's the way of living. There's something wrong with your thinking if you don't think that elbow looks like a good soup bone. And especially those people who are white, because that's really unique. You listen to me. God, the Holy Ghost, has come to teach us a whole other realm of living. I'm just trying to get something across to you by using extreme examples. He's come to teach us a whole other realm. We are so satisfied with what we do and what we how we behave and what we think that we really aren't really desperate for something more, and God's calling us not to live our lives as mere men. You know, Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, when he talked about the situation that existed, the church at Corinth, and he said, you guys, some say you're of Apollos, some say you're of Peter, some say you belong to this denomination, some say you belong to that denomination. And he says to them, he says, you're behaving here as mere men. God's come to teach us by the Holy Ghost a whole other dimension of living. And this is, once again, this is a concept too deep for most people. That the Lord has literally come to teach us how to properly behave. He's come to teach us the richness of what love is meant to be, what He created love to be, what love is by the very existence of who He is, because He's the source of it. And we know very little of it. And what little of it we know, it's good. It's good, we get excited about it, we enjoy it to some degree, but we don't know how to go deep with it. And because as soon as some kind of offense or some kind of issue comes along, once again, like I said previously, we'll throw it away, we'll throw the relationship away like an old garment and think nothing of it and go on. That isn't love. And joy and peace and all these wonderful things that the Holy Spirit wants to teach us, here's what I want you to get. I've used these extreme examples for you now, but here's what I want you to get. I want you to get this, that the Holy Spirit wants to come and teach you things that is literally a reproach to the world. He wants to teach you things that is foolishness to men. He wants to teach you things that you, by and large, and your first response are going to reject. Because you won't fit in. The world, Jesus said, the world doesn't know me. In fact, the world hates me. Everything about me testifies that it is demonic. That the world is, everything about me testifies to mankind and the world around me that it is demonic. It is something twisted. It is not what is right. But everybody now has comforted themselves in their relativisms and in their comparisons to say, oh, we're all grouped up over here. We're right. We're together in this thing. And if you behave differently or think differently, you're the outsider and we are going to reject you and we are going to persecute you. We are going to say that you are weird. That there's something seriously wrong with you. Now I'm going to set this up for you And now, in a few verses of scripture, and then come back here and talk about a little bit, maybe a little bit more about Mary. But I want you to look with me, for example, in Matthew and chapter 5. And I want you to understand that the Lord is not talking here in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 10 about your religious ideologies. He's talking about the expression of the Holy Ghost in your life. He's talking about the expression of God. Did you know that Christ Jesus, there's an opportunity for you today to have God come and live on the inside of you, to come walk in your life, to come teach you something that is so much better than what you are and what you have right now, that once you start receiving what he has to give, listen to me, you won't want to be without it. You'll want more. It'll be the best. It's like the best food you've ever eaten. You can't go back to the old stuff. It's the best kind of, you know, it's the best environment you've ever been in. You can't go back to the former way. So this is the threshold for which many people will not cross over. They're very satisfied with their life. And then when people come along and approve them, and people come along and tell them how wonderful they're doing, how great they are, all they become is more rooted within the framework of that which has nothing to do with what God wants to take you, or nothing to do with what God wants to show you and where God wants to take you. Jesus shows us where God wants to take us, but we've got a fictitious Jesus in many of our belief system because we made him purely religious. We don't understand the Jesus of the four Gospels who came to show us God, reveal Father God to us. We don't understand, nor can we relate to, Christ Jesus who walks in lowliness and meekness, who comes at his greatest moment of celebration riding on a little donkey, not a stallion, not a white stallion. He would have come on the bicycle, not the Rolls Royce kind of thing. Are you listening to me? We can't even relate to that. Come on, be honest. You can't relate to that. Can't relate to that. Because he's in an entirely separate realm. We are influenced by the atmosphere of a lie, of pride, of deception, of all these things that are constantly wanting the approval of men to please men. God says, as long as you want to please men, you are so far from me that you're still over in a realm called darkness. You're not even near where I want you to be. Why? Because he's got something wrong with us approving one another? No, because our culture and our caste system and the realm in which we've been born and taught to behave and act is governed by a power called satanic. And so long as we're looking for approval, did I do that right? Did I behave right? Am I okay? Is this good? And we're getting that approval and that feedback from a demonic realm, we're never moving on with God. Somebody's got to get in your face and say, you're not good enough. And nothing that you ever do will be good enough. You're not right. That's not the proper way. Then they'll exit out the door quickly. Because people don't want, listen to me. By and large, people don't want that. They don't. Jesus says, you hate me because I tell you and I show you that your deeds are evil. Who's he talking to? He's talking to the best of the best. From a purely religious point of view, he's talking to the best of the best. He's talking to the people who were at 4 years old given over to the priesthood to learn every scripture in the Bible, to memorize it, to give themselves completely, totally over to the service of God. He's talking about the best of the best. He's not just talking about religious from some foreign religion. He's talking about religious from the Jewish tradition, which is after God, after the law. Listen to how he's saying, what he's saying. He says, you hate me because I show you that your deeds are evil. I show you that you all living under the prince and the power of the atmosphere. You've never allowed the word of God to take you where God's calling you to be and where he's calling you to go. You're stuck in Adam's darkness. You're stuck in Adam's sin. You're stuck in a world where everything about your life has been fashioned and formed in everything that I reject and I oppose. That's hard because none of us think our sin's very bad. And if we did, we'd never do it again. None of us believe that our sin is a crime against the Most High God that carries with it a righteous judgment of being killed. It carries with it the death penalty. None of us believe that. Well, very few of us. We've had to be taught by God to believe that. We've had to have an encounter to see, you know, I mean, look at Job. Job is righteous and upright. God says so. But when Job has an encounter with God, he says, I'm undone. I abhor myself. The pride of life, the spirit of this world will never allow you to abhor yourself. You're doing everything you can do to accomplish just the opposite. When the prophet, the great prophet Isaiah, who stood in the place of God, came and presented the word of God to Israel, and he's showing them their sin and showing them how different that they are from God and how much they must change. Suddenly, he has another encounter with God. Obviously, he had a great encounter with God to become God's prophet, to have the Spirit of the Lord upon him so that he was declaring the word of God. That's amazing. But now he has another encounter with God, and he says, I'm unclean, I'm undone. Depart from me, Lord. I'm unclean, I'm undone. Once again, if you're contrasting, comparing yourself to another devil, you may look pretty good. Are you listening to me? But when you contrast and compare yourself to the holy, living God, all God Almighty, you undone, you messed up, you bad off. God said to us, he said, I will walk in the midst of you. I will set my tabernacle in the midst of you so that I will no longer abhor you. We're like, what? Abhor? There's a translation problem. No, actually, it's even worse than that. He said, I'm going to set my tabernacle. I'm going to set something of life and truth in the midst of you that will have an influence on you, that will begin to affect you, that as you closer you get to the tabernacle, closer you get to my presence, the more you'll begin to put a damper on that behavior of yours that is absolutely a reproach and abomination to me. Now, if we could get this, all of a sudden we would become extremely dependent upon the Holy Ghost. We'd go, oh, God. I'm tired of my love being like hate. I'm tired of my peace just being another form of distress. I'm tired of my joy just being something that the comedian can produce. See, someone else can come along like a comedian, he can produce joy in you by saying something funny. A giggle and a happy, ha 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 ha, that's so funny, ha ha. Well, that is a total demonic realm. You say, oh, that's not a demonic realm. It's all a demonic realm. God says it's all darkness, that the whole world lies in sin, that the whole world is under the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in children of disobedience. Jesus came declaring and revealing and making this known. But see, the more beautiful thing is God, the Holy Ghost comes and says, I want to produce in you, I want to activate something in you that's real joy, something that you can't activate. See, the comedian activated something in you that you couldn't activate, right? Because you were unhappy, you were disappointed. All of a sudden, you feel a little giggly, you know, a little happy for a moment, right? Because somebody made you laugh. Well, God says, I alone can access and create within you real joy, true joy, great joy, everlasting joy. And I want to, but you've got to be willing to be different. And that's hard. You got to be willing to be weird. And that's hard. You got to be willing to be a reproach. And that's hard. Mary, you're pregnant. In a community where everybody knows what you had for breakfast. In a community that has a caste system that if you commit fornication, you are dead. I guarantee you there's nobody in that community that liked Mary from that day on. I guarantee you there was nobody in that community who liked Joseph for that day on because he did not bring charges up against her. And if he didn't bring charges up against her, then he was a part of that fornication because they had no right to have that kind of relationship until after the formal engagement was done. They didn't like him. She had to bear a reproach so that the anointing could be made manifest. She had to be different. She had to be an outcast. This is the way it works. You listen to me. This is the way it works. Moses knew the call of God upon his life. And he fit in. He was basically the nephew of Pharaoh, the son of Pharaoh's sister. And he looked at the reproaches of Christ. And he said, I would rather have the reproaches of Christ. I'd rather be out there where the glory is. I'd rather be out there where the eternal call of God is. I'd rather be out there in that place where the reality of what we're truly meant to be and created to be. See, Satan rebelled against God and attempted and has successfully done so, created an entirely different realm for which the whole world now goes in its course. And men are so deceived in their relativisms that they can't even take a second look to say, wait, you know what? That's true. They're just so deceived, they just categorize what I'm talking about today as nothing more than religion. But Moses said, I would rather have the reproaches of Christ than to have the riches of the world, than to be in the palace, be called the nephew of Pharaoh. But the question is, would you? And where does that really come to bear in our lives? About the time that the power of God begins to move, and now you're feeling something that you've never felt before, and you begin to behave in a way that you've never behaved before. I could jump real quickly from Mary now having to bear the reproach of being pregnant, and nobody's who are you going to convince that you got pregnant by God? Listen to me. You're not only a fornicator, but you're a liar. And you probably have mental problems. And it goes on. This is the whole, I'm not talking about an isolated situation. I'm talking about a realm opposed to the world. I'm talking about how the world is always going to feel about the anointing and the things that God is doing. I'm talking about the more you move over into the realms of cooperating with God, the more the persecution, the more the reproach. Huh? This is the way it is. And this is the threshold. People kind of stick their toe over and go, wow, that's really good over there, but too much persecution with that. Too weird. And the Lord's really radical about it. He takes the foolish things. He takes what men call foolish. Let me put it that way. He takes that which men calls foolish. Huh? He doesn't set it up, and he could have set it up, to where Jesus was born in the greatest luxury and what you and I would define how we picture God. Now, a loving, caring God, this is his only begotten son. Tell me what kind of accommodations is he going to make for him? And just go into your relativisms, go into what you believe would be right, and you're totally wrong. Because he's going to be born in a stable, in a barn, in the hay that the cows were laying on. He's going to be born in the lowliest places that can be found in the earth. Why? Because there's no room for him in the world. He will be an outcast. And Jesus is an outcast to this day. The world cannot know him. The world cannot know you because it does not know him. The world will hate you because it hates him. You're going to have to understand this, dear people, and quit riding the fence of trying to be acceptable. Because when God comes and says, I'm going to show you now how to move in the realms of truth. I'm going to show you how to move in the realms of life. I'm going to begin to teach you what real love is so that it can be developed in you. He pours out the Holy Ghost and we become as those who babble. And to this day, and it's getting worse, the gift was persecuted, the gift of tongues, which is one of the most important gifts in the Bible, was persecuted into oblivion before the third century, before 300 years passed to the church. There was a revival of it on a larger scale, as most people are aware of, in 1906, and I guarantee you it is being persecuted once again into oblivion. It's being persecuted into a place where for you to do it, you will become the outcast. Because why? It is a manifestation of Christ Jesus, a manifestation of the anointing. It is a means now where men are communicating in a heavenly realm and not in an earthly realm. And that is intolerable. Watch out, because the prince of the power of the air, the atmosphere, imposes more thoughts on you than any of the education system that you've been through. It imposes upon you more conclusions than any, the greatest mind that has ever lived in the human realm could impact you with. I'm going to tell you right now, the majority, if not all, conclusions that men have that have not been born of the Spirit and are not relying upon the Word of God and the Spirit of God are 100% false, demonic, based on a relative world that has outcomes, but has outcomes that are convoluted with intervention by the demonic. And there's a lot to say there. I could break that down. I'm talking to you to help you understand that there's a whole lot more going on than what you're aware of. There's a whole lot, there's a thing we learned early on and you know, as we're developing in clinical science, and especially from the crazy notions that you get out of the funny experimentation, funny science of psychology. It's called sham feeding. And then there's another one. It's called superstitious dance. And if I just give you that one, if the mouse did a little thing, little jiggle, the food chamber would open and he could eat. So the mouse thought, all I got to do is this little jiggle and the food will open and I can eat. It's a superstitious dance. It was all created as behavioral science. It was manipulating the situation. You understand me? Yeah. So now we do these things and we think, oh, I'm onto something, right? But there is someone pulling the trigger, opening up the food gate, just so that you can be convinced that your little dance really was the means by which that food gate was opened up and you had nothing to do with it. Are you catching my meaning? I'm talking about things convoluting outcomes that go beyond what you can see or perceive. I'm talking to you. I'm trying to get at a place why it is so important that you come to be governed by the Word of God and that you live by the Word of God alone and that you don't in any way redefine or try to make it fit into your circumstance. I'm talking to you about a place where you come now because you're willing to live by the Word of God, where you rely upon the Holy Spirit to lead you because He's the Spirit of truth and He's going to show you what's really going on behind the scenes that's manipulating you, which you've now, because you've got these evidences, which are all scientific data is anecdotal, if you know what that means. It's just perceived to be factual because of trends. All this stuff is nonsense, dear people, that people have put their trust in. God has come to show us a whole nother realm of living where we're not trying to mitigate our circumstances and dealing with diseases and dealing with relationship problems between individuals and between even nations. I'm doing my very best to encompass everything, not only in your life, but that surrounds your life, that you grabbed a hold of and held on to and ultimately trusted in. And as a result, you basically have the same kind of thinking, the same kind of mannerisms, and you basically deduce or conclude the same kind of outcomes. So that you're listening to CNN and you're going, oh, I agree with that. That's nonsense. What are you agreeing with? You don't know half of what was just said. You know, oh, I agree that Syria is this and that. What are you talking about? Have you been there? Do you know what's being manipulated behind the scenes just by governments? And then do you know what's manipulated behind the scenes on another level from a spiritual dynamic of what Satan is doing, what God is allowing Satan to do? Do you hear me? Am I getting somewhere here? Can I get you to believe that everything that you think is true is really false? Unless it's the Word of God. And it's the Word of God not as it's redefined by dogma, by denominational doctrinisms. That I could get you out of the human... I got a word that I use. It's my word. You can have it too. Mentality. Human mentality. Because I'm telling you, it's taking you nowhere. It's not going to take you to heaven. It's not going to take you to flowing and operating in the Holy Ghost. It's not going to take you to a place where you can yield to the Spirit of the Lord. I'm going to tell you, the more the anointing is manifested, the more the Word of God is manifested, the more the anointing of God is manifested in your life, the more you're going to be hated, the more you're going to be talked bad about. Just let healing increase in your life. You're going to become a reproach. Just let the anointing that produces healing increase in your life. There's going to be more people that say that you're a charlatan, that it's make-believe, that you said something that wasn't real. Everybody, where? Because there's an atmosphere creating a lie that is persecuting the anointing. That wants to destroy the child before it is born. And then after it's born, it will hunt the child to destroy the child so the child could not grow. Happened in the time of Moses, happened in the time of Jesus. Happens in your time too, the moment you're born of the Spirit, the moment you're born of God. Oh, could we get, should we all of a sudden have a better ability to perceive and understand what's really going on? Should we begin to see the thief that really is in existence working against our life? We would hold tight to the Word of God and cry out to the Holy Spirit and say, I really want to understand. I really want to know what love is. I want to be taught of you. And he's going to tell you, well, it's going to look foolish. Are you ready for that? It's going to be a reproach. Are you ready for that? It's going to be persecuted. Are you ready for that? Because as soon as the word is sown, persecution is going to come. Soon as the word, especially as soon as the word takes any kind of root, the word is going to always have persecution with it. It really is emphasized when the seed is sown among thorns and having not much earth. As soon as it's sprung up, it doesn't have a lot of depth, okay? Because it's all of the rocky ground. It's hard for those tender roots to get through the rocks. The plant's got to develop more before the root can get through the rock. But because it's a tender root system, no sooner does the sun come up and it scorches it. And what did the Lord Jesus liken that unto? As soon as the word takes root, you're going to get persecuted because the prince of the power of the air has purposed to destroy the word and the anointing before it can produce any fruit. And one of his primary sources that he uses is religion. He'll use the most subtle means. He'll come at you with the most cloaked process, if you would, and position and group. The Word of God. It is very rare for the Word of God to be declared and for the Word of God to be preached. It's rare. It's mixed with dogma and ideas and philosophy and ideology. And Paul talked about it. He said, you're going to get spoiled. They're going to spoil you. They're already working in the church. They take the Word of God, they mix it with philosophy, and then you're spoiled. They mix it with their ideology. They mix it with their culture. And it's wrong. Oh, it ain't that bad. Oh, it's really, really, it's actually worse than that. It's worse. Because now you've accepted it as truth and it's a lie, and now you're doubly damned. Now the light that is in you is darkness. Because we think, oh, well, the Lord's more tolerable than that. Mercy has nothing to do with tolerance and vice versa. Mercy is an opportunity for you to get it right, and God's not mixing with nothing. Well, doesn't he compromise? No, compromise is totally demonic. God demands agreement. Compromise is, well, okay, you take what you believe, and I'll take what I believe, and we'll meet halfway. Ain't it happening? It's demonic. That's how Satan gets it done. In fact, he'll say, I tell you what, you take what you believe, 99% of what you believe, and I come in with 1%. And he'll take the 1% and he'll make the whole 99% a lie. A little bit of leaven leavens the whole lump. A little bit of agreement with a lie, there is no end. A little compromise, there is no end. God's not God something that is evolving. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He doesn't change. He is the unchanging God, immutable, unchanging. When somebody says, oh, but this is the 21st century. Hey, 1,000 years with God is as a day. And as a day is 1,000 years. There is no new defining of anything. He's exactly the same way now as he was 1 billion years ago. And will be exactly the same way 1 billion years from now as he is now. He's got it right. It's not evolving. It's not relative. It's absolute. Pretty radical stuff, ain't it? Well, we just can't handle that. Here it is. Oh, you Bible thumpers. Yes. More than that. Absolutisms that cannot in any way be altered. Not a jot, not a tittle, not a letter, not any part of punctuation. It will not pass away until every bit of it is fulfilled. It's God's word. He watches over, as he said to Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 7, I watch over it to perform it. My word is forever settled in heaven. My word is your judge and your judgment. Uh-oh. Now you can just see it. Can't you just see the whole community of humanity as they now sort out just on those things that I've laid out here? There's very few people standing over here with me. In the sea of humanity, there's very people stand, few people standing over here with God. Are you listening to me? Is it not obvious? Oh, well, his word, you know, it's been, you know, it's been, what do most people like to say? They don't even know the terminology properly, you know. They can't even, oh, there's many translations. So what? Still just one word of God. Still, there's only one text from which they translated all those many translations. So what are you saying? Are you saying that there's many words of God, that there's many original text? You're wrong. There's only one. There's 99% homology between the whole community of 5,600 extant manuscripts, 13,000 lectionaries, and I can go on. It's nonsense. It's nonsense. It's Satan's ploy, speaking a lie. People don't go and investigate it and really find out what they're talking about. They just go ahead, because there's whole communities of religion don't even want you reading the Bible. Huh? Recently it was said by somebody who's supposed to be in authority that a personal relationship is with Jesus Christ is a very dangerous thing. Yeah, it is. It'll change the world. They didn't go on to say that. But that's religion for you. Don't want you to get alone with God. Don't want you to get hungry and thirsty after righteousness. Listen to this. God's calling you, and no one can hold you back but you. God's open. Christ Jesus has opened up a door for you to come out of darkness, and nobody can lock that door but you. He even stands at the heart when we get all messed up and all tweaked in our thinking and all broke down. He stands at the door of our heart knocking, banging. It's not a little tap, tap, tap like some timid little person at your door that wants to sell you something they don't believe in. It's a banging. As a person is screaming at you, there's a fire, get out of the house. Behold, he stands at the door of your heart knocking, if any man will hear him knocking and open up the door. See, as far as the door and access to heaven, it's wide open to all men. God is calling all men. He's made a way through the blood sacrifice. Jesus made a blood sacrifice so that all men can come. The only place that there's any door shut is it's man shutting the door on God and closing himself in with the world that he likes and perceives to be accurate, which is going to do nothing but continually abuse him and threaten him. Now listen, I know that some of the things that I've said here is hard to understand. I know it just really messes with your whole security system and what your sense of security and your sense of well-being and your sense of right and wrong. I just want to tell you, your definitions of right and wrong are completely invalid. Men's systems of right and wrong are completely wrong. Men will never say that sin is a crime against God which carries the death penalty that he demands in his justice to be executed. God in his mercy towards man provided the blood sacrifice through Jesus Christ. But God in his judgment will not allow. Listen, think about it. God in his mercy, no matter how wicked a person is, they could be the most wicked, vile person that has ever existed, and God in his mercy has made a way for them to become as pure and as clean as he is. Radical stuff. That's mercy. But his judgment is just as his mercy, and he will not allow the wicked to continue, for they are an abomination to him, and he will cut them off eternally. That's what he says. Now all of a sudden, relativism, humanism comes out and says, well, that doesn't make any sense to me if a loving God. What your problem is that you're so locked within the influence of the prince of the power of the air, you do not know how bad sin is. All you know is how your perceptions and how your humanistic thoughts of compassion and mercy would lead you down the road to allowing something that is a disease that will ruin everything to continue to exist. Do you hear me? Can you understand? God's just in all of his judgments. And he says every sin is worthy of death. The wages of sin is death. And that he will execute that death. And he showed by, he would think that there's another God in the Old Testament, not the same God. He said, if you have a rebellious child, bring them before the elders of the city and stone him to death that you may crush sin out of the heart of Israel. Can't we go through therapy? I'm sure there's something to work with. No, God, there's no. See, we're starting to distance ourselves, aren't we? We're getting way over here now. We're extreme. God is extreme. And everything in His Word, don't just take a part of His Word, take it all. From Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21, God is absolutely extreme. He's extremely biased and what men would call very narrow-minded because He wants no one else's influence and He's not going to consider it. Huh? He's got one man in the earth, Abraham, He's willing to have a conversation with. He said, should I hide from Abraham that which I'm about to do, seeing as I shall make him the father of many nations? I'm going to go down and see if Sodom and Gomorrah is bad and is beyond help as it's been reported to me. And if so, I'm destroying it. Abraham goes, should not the judge of all the earth do that which is right? And Father said, I'm listening. He doesn't argue on the basis of how wickedness isn't that bad. Now the Lord needs to learn how to be a little bit more tolerant with other people's choices. He argues on the basis, how about the righteous being there? I had a whole bunch of family went down there. I've got at least 300 souls down there, family. Lot's family and servants, basically is what he's thinking, or at least 50. More than that went down. He said, if there's 50 righteous, will you save it? He said, I'll save it for 50. He said, how about 40? He said, I'll save it for 40. He says, oh, Lord, forgive me. I'm imposing on you now. How about minus 5? And then he works his way from minuses now. He works all the way down to 10. The Lord says, 10, I'll save it. For you, because of your intercession. For you. I'll spare it. For 10. Because with 10 righteous there, potentially there is a hope of change. There's an influence. There's a light. In that context, the Lord talks to us about the light. Being a light. And it's not all of, you know, your good Sam Club deeds. Huh? Your Qantas, Qantas Club membership, what is that? Huh? What is that? I get these all messed up. Huh? No. The various, huh? Qantas? Whatever it is. All these various different little clubs, society clubs that you get to be a part of, and you go out and you feed the poor. Bless your darling heart. What's that doing for you? I'm glad you're feeding them. But if you think that's doing anything, if you think that's getting you some bonus points, I'm telling you right now, it's actually giving you minus points just because you think that. If you didn't think that, you might actually have some benefit. But because you think it's doing you some value and doing you some good and now making you better, it's actually taking you into the red. Huh? Listen to me. Here's the thing. There is not a human being on the planet that is acceptable to God. He rejects you hands down. He says your father is the devil. Can you get that? Yeah. Now, they're calling 911 now. Saying it's not right for such a man to live. Do you hear what he's saying? Yes. He's an extremist. I am. God would that all men be saved. Yeah. Saved from what? The demonic realm that you were born into. The demonic realm that shaped you, that has developed and mentored your perceptions and your behaviors. That everybody around you says is socially acceptable and they like, so long as you're not murdering anybody, yet. Of course, no, there is a socially acceptable form of murder today. 62 million babies from the womb. The god Moloch is still just as much alive as he's ever been. He demands baby sacrifice. And he's a demon spirit. He's a fallen angel. And he demands it. And he influences, and though you're not bowing down to an idol as they were 2,500 to 3,000 years ago, you're just doing it another way. To a scientific, you know, intellectual, humanist system that is also a god that demands obedience, that demands you bow to it. You bow, or we're putting you in jail. You bow. They call it a legal system. It's not a legal system. Huh? Any kind of a legal system that would in any way defy the law of God is tyranny. Which will ultimately bring you and subjugate you into a place of absolute control. and tyranny. Men don't know anything about it. For the past 1,800 years, men have, the earth has been relatively quiet and peaceful compared to the emperors of Rome, compared to the deities and imperialism of Greece, and the Xerxes of Persia and Media Persia. The Persians have been a mighty people for 5,000 years. Watch out. They might be a little country. They ruled the world for a big part of human history. Hello. Are you listening to me? We know nothing about the tyranny of what it looks like in Babylonianism and what it looked like for the Sargons of Assyria. The pharaohs of Egypt, who were taught by the Nimrods of Cush, the descendant of Ham. Look, the Bible tells us, unfolds to us a history of humanity. Secular history unfolds to us a history of humanity. Because of the quietness and of the earth that has come since Christ Jesus and an open door and opportunity for all men to be saved. People, we can't even begin to relate to what's getting ready to happen, what God is getting, Jesus has been exalted above all principalities, powers, and might, and he's about to let Satan have his run right up the middle. He's about to let men have what they've been crying out for, no God. Break off, remove their restraints from off of us and take away their restrictions from us. Watch what happens when the Lord does that. You can't even begin to relate to how Nimrod hunted all men with his nets to subjugate them. Human life is nothing to them. Nothing to men possessed by the devil that are given such, as it were, rights and liberties to subjugate man. It's going to happen again. The Antichrist is the man who fully reveals the mystery of iniquity. He is the worst tyrant that is. As Christ was the purest man that ever lived, Antichrist is the most wicked and vile that has ever lived. And he's about to come on the scene. And things are being developed so that he can come on the scene. And people just have no idea. And here the Holy Ghost is working with us and saying, I want to show you how to build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. And people, as soon as you start praying in the Holy Ghost, people are going to leave. As soon as you start moving in Pentecost, it is going to cause you to be developed within the realms of the Holy Spirit, being able to take over your emotions, your attitudes, your behaviors, your passions, your appetites, your attitudes. People are going to leave. This is weird. This is crazy. Jesus bore the reproach. He went outside the camp and suffered the shame of complete rejection for you and me, and says to us, hey, come on out. Come out from among them, out here in the reproach where I'm at, in the rejection that I'm at. Mary says, believe whatever you want to believe. I got God. God's here. God's in me. Believe whatever you want to believe. I'm here happy. Be it unto me according to your word. It's easy for us to sit there and feel, goose pimples about that. No butterflies. Goose pimples. Oh, that is so beautiful. Be it unto me according to your word. That means I'm getting ready to be rejected by even my own parents. That means I could possibly be stoned out of this. All the people that looked at me as virtuous and sweet and pure and wonderful and us thought I was one of the best girls in the community are going to now, from now on, they won't even look at me. It will actually make them unclean to even look at me. They won't even touch me. They won't talk to me. It will cause them to be polluted to even talk to me. Hello, this is Jesus. This is the anointing. You interested? Yes. Really? Yes. You're really interested? I know that some of you are, as you're saying that, because you wouldn't have lasted around here this long if you weren't. Because that's what happens immediately. You know, that's what happens. The anointing of the Holy Ghost begins to move and things start separating out. People say, this is weird. This is emotionalism. Yeah, it is emotionalism. It's a holy emotion. Yes. And it's different from your ugly emotionalism, your demonic emotionalism. And you think your demonic emotionalism is good because everybody around you tells you it's good, and because that's the way you were formed and shaped, and that's your whole caste system, and you don't know any better, any more than the cannibals don't know any better about eating other people. Hello. You listening to me? Because I'm going to tell you right now, relativism has no end. That's why comparison is totally demonic. You're not wise, you compare yourself to others. It's a demonic realm, as much as competition is. Uh-oh. We enjoy that, don't we? Woo, yeah, wah. The Greek gods, that's where it was all born. Go do your history. Oh, it ain't that anymore. Oh, yeah, it is. Yeah, it is. So when did it get sanctified? So when did it get modernized? So when did it become acceptable to God? Can you hear me? I know it's hard, isn't it? I know, I'm just turned way down. Because you have to try to take what information I have and connect it to all the dots of those things that you already believe. And if the dots don't connect, it's rejected. You with me? There's a mental block for most people with mathematics for that reason. And I could talk about some other, in chemistry, there's some mental blocks. But God the Holy Ghost is here to make up the difference. That's the only good, and that's the only possibility for you and me. We'd never get it unless it was God the Holy Ghost coming here, helping us to make up the slack, make up the lack. Can you hear me? I hope that your behaviors that are not like the Holy Ghost becomes exceedingly reproachful to you. I hope that your attitudes and your way of thinking that is contrary to the ways taught to us by God becomes something that you abhor. Huh? God said, I'm going to put my tabernacle among you that I may not abhor you. Job has the encounter with the tabernacle and says, I abhor myself. In other words, he agreed with God. When he saw himself in view of Father, he said, you're right. And come on now, I'm talking to you. I'm trying to get through because I know we just are all about making ourselves feel better about ourselves. How am I doing now? Do you still like me? I don't think they like me over there anymore. You just become so insecure. Tell me again that I'm okay. You know that the majority of people live in that? Tell me again that I'm okay. The majority of people constantly are beating themselves up. They feel like a failure, feel like a disappointment, and they're trying so hard to get approval. And it's a trap. It's a monkey trap. It is a monkey trap, and it works just as silly and ridiculously as a monkey trap works. Everybody knows how a monkey trap works? The monkey reaches into the cage. He grabs the banana. He's trapped. All he's got to do is let go of the banana, and he can get out. But he's not going to. His passion overrides his ability to reason. He's got a one-track mind. Banana in mouth. Are you hot? Hell's a whole lot hotter. And if you didn't live in air conditioning cars and an air conditioning house, it wouldn't be hot at all. It's all relativisms. If you would have walked to church and you walked every day of your life and you lived outside in the elements, you'd be feeling good. Especially if you just come over here from Nevada and you live every day in 115. You're like, woo, breezy. Relativisms. Get over here in the Holy Ghost. Get over here in the fire of His presence. And all of a sudden, everything you've been happy about, you don't want it anymore. You'll hate your life in this world, as Jesus said. You'll hate it. Why? Because you'll have discovered the glory of what it really means to live. You'll understand what it was that I purposed to do when I created Adam, shaped him, formed him in my own image, in my own likeness. And you'll look back on your life in the world, and you'll hate it. People trying religiously to hate their life in the world. That's religion. People are trying to go sell all the ham that they may obtain a pearl of great price, and they've never seen the pearl. That's religion. I'm trying to like the pearl. What if you could just see the pearl? You'd love the pearl, and you go sell everything that you have. If you could see that you have a treasure in the hidden field, you go sell all that you may have, that you may obtain this field. The encounter with God that has been brought to us right now by the power of the Holy Ghost, that is made prepared for us by Christ Jesus, is something all you and I have to do is get desperate about and hungry for, and He'll come fill us. If you hunger and thirst after these things, He'll come fill you. What happens is persecution. In 1983, we had a great move of God up in Del Mar. 1982, 1983. We had a great move of God up in Del Mar, here in San Diego. And a lot of the people that were coming were the children of the professors at UCSD. And they were coming and they were getting baptized in the Holy Ghost, and they were like, I've never realized anything like this could even exist. It was amazing, beautiful thing. It wasn't within a month and religion persecutions came and said, oh, all that's wrong. You can't speak in tongues. Oh, that's wrong. They're emotional. They're carried away. And those people lost their salvation. Their persecution stole from them the move of God. Didn't steal it from me. I've been keep on going. I've been just continued on. Huh? But this happens all the time. People have a move. They have an encounter with God. And then at various different levels, they're influenced. Oh, don't agree with that. You better watch it. You better be careful about that. I'm not saying anything. I'm just kind of warning you. You foul spirit of hell. That's exactly what the devil does. That's exactly the demonic realm that comes and sows a little bit of seed of suspicion, criticism, fear. He's a fear monger. His whole system works around fear. It is a bondage system. The Lord has made us sons, and we're no longer under in bondage to fear anymore, but now can say, Abba, Father. You can say what you want. And I'm not going back because it's good. It's not of me, but of him. Teaches me how to begin to give myself over to holy emotions. Hallelujah. But it's an offense to the world. What are they doing now? It's offense, especially to the religious world. I always, many times when I say that, the Lord will bring me back to a time. I was sitting in a back seat with a guy who's who in the world of genetics, an amazing, brilliant geneticist. Many breakthroughs in genetics took place in his life. Up front is a couple of other relatively famous people. One of them is a very famous person, molecular biologist. And we were going out to eat. And I kind of just forgot where I was at, you know. And I was looking out the window and see, and I got inspired. Begin to come out of my mouth. And the geneticist who had just previously been asking me about the quantum energy of fluorazine said, wow, that is a beautiful language. What language is that? I said, that's the heavenly one. Had no problem with it. It is beautiful language, unless you've been tainted by religion. Now you're all offended. That's demonic. That's a religious person saying that. Usually not of the world. I've not really found many people in the world who know nothing about the Spirit of the Lord have a problem with it. It's religion. There is nothing so evil as religion, because there is nothing so blinding to the heart and to the mind and the spirit against the things of God than religion. And that's why I hate it so much. I don't really express the depth of how much I hate it, simply because I don't want to alienate myself from everybody. But I really hate it. I don't want to alienate myself as much as God is alienated. And you know I'm just kidding. Because the Lord Jesus said, the reproaches wherewith they've reproached you have fallen on me. I'm taking it in the ribs for you, Lord. You want me to show you how many times the Lord actually said that? Psalms 22. Beginning of verse 6 is one of them. It's verse 9. But you open up with Jesus describing the reproach and the rejection that he is encountering from men. Huh? Do you know what Psalm 22:1 is? Right? Huh? Hello. Because you've got your treasure. How many of you know where your diamonds are today? Huh? How many of you know how much you have in gold today? Silver? Huh? Do you know your word? Do you know the word of God? Do you know the value and the purity and the beauty of my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why are you so far from my crying, O Lord? Psalm 22:1. When you get around about verse 26, he begins to go on to discover and reveal all the rejections and all the reproaches and how that nobody can relate to him and how that he is no man, that he is a worm. People look at him. I mean, when's the last time somebody looked at you and said, I just think you're a worm? Where you so reproached that you're like a worm and no man. You're not even you're regarded as subhuman. Read it. I know we flower it up and we make it something different. Literally, it's subhuman. That's the way they treated Jesus. That's the anointing. Now, why are you, now what's going to happen to you? Next time the beauty and the glory of God begins to move on your life, and this, if you've been giving yourself to listening to the influences of the spirit of this world, you're going to be getting, there's something going to go on in your head and say, that's ridiculous. That's stupid. That's silly. My. What's wrong with you? Have you lost, taken all leave of your senses? I'm going to go on. How do you want me to continue on? Blowing up and making everything that is human look purely ugly. The evil that it really is. You know where man goes without the intervention of God? Or you know where man goes even with the intervention of God? Let's just talk about where men go with the intervention of God. The imagination of their heart is only wicked continually. Now tell me, was there redemption in the flood for the heart of man? Was there any redemption in the flood for the heart of man? Absolutely not. I'm sorry that you hesitate. Can you not hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Was there any redemption in the heart of men to the flood that took place in the days of Noah?
No.
Now you can say with great confidence, no. I wish that you could have said earlier, no. People, we've got it. We've never seen the contrast. Only the Holy Spirit can come and convince us of sin. And we've got to have to start listening to Him. Otherwise, we're going to justify sin. God will never justify the wicked. We'll justify it. We'll justify it. We'll have relativisms. All of a sudden, sin won't be so bad. The sin we allow, it's just not going to be so bad. It's going to be tolerable. It's totally intolerable. In reality, it's totally intolerable. And if we could have the wisdom of God and the insight that the Holy Spirit would like to bring to us, we wouldn't have it in our life. We would have the same kind of restraint against it that we have against cannibalism right now. Anybody tempted? Are you listening to me? This is hard to hear, I know. It's Sunday morning. Couldn't you give us this? This is Sunday morning. It's supposed to be Holy Ghost light. No, Word of God light. We can't endure sound doctrine. We can't endure the Word of God. Somebody tell us that He's wrong. Oh, I hear the world crying that out. That's what the Spirit of the Lord causes us to realize. That's what the world's saying. Somebody tell us that God's wrong. Please tell us that He doesn't exist. Please tell us that He's not going to come with the severity of judgment. And Jesus, like a person with their shoes off, trampling the grapes, to make the juice, is going to come stomp men. And the scripture says, why has His garment dipped in blood? Because He's been treading out the winepress of God's wrath. Humanism has no cat. You have no filing cabinet for that. That's something like tyranny. That's we would call evil. See, Satan creates it to where that we call good evil, and we call evil good. And then we see various different examples of that. We're seeing an example of this right now, because never in a society historically has a society said that the marriage between a man and a man and a woman and a woman should be sanctified and equivalent to a marriage between a man and a woman, because everybody knew they wanted to hold on to their power and their kingdom, and if you mess with the family unit, it would destroy your power system. So never have we been so stupid as we are now. Look at history. Oh no, these are advances in the human evolution. Well, if that's advances in the human evolution, I predict it comes to an end very soon. Because we can extrapolate, and we can see no more species on several different levels. Praise God for His mercy here. When will we start agreeing with God to the point that we say, Lord, You're right about everything? Because right now He's right about half of things. Some of the rest we're not sure yet, because it don't fit into any category, into our thinking and our behavior and the way we're going to perceive the world around us. And if we did, we would become fundamentalist, narrow-minded, radical people. But you would be beautiful, because you'd be full of love if you were right. You'd be full of joy. You'd be laying down your life. You'd walk in meekness and lowliness. You'd go before, you know, those who are going to kill you as a lamb to the slaughter. No resistance. So you'd be a blessing while you're radical and fundamentalist. all the most dangerous people on the planet are people like Mark Spitzbergen. He's a fundamentalist Christian. He's got no place in any of his belief systems for homosexuality, transvestitism, and whatever other isms, and cannibalisms, and sorceryisms. He's got no place. Look, I'm just going to tell you that you're on your way to hell. It's not like we're going to kill you. We're not going to strap bombs on ourselves and it'll blow you up. So how am I the most dangerous person on the planet? I'm not blowing nothing up. We're just telling you, you're wrong, because we love you. And you got the Lord loves you so much that he's made a way for you to be pure. Jesus offered a blood sacrifice so you could be pure. And he didn't take a bull and a lamb. He took his own blood and offered the blood sacrifice so that you could be pure, so that you could be changed by the Holy Ghost, so God himself would come and live on the inside of you and teach you how to walk with him and put his ways on the inside of you and write his word in your mind and your thoughts so that you could do them. Because that's the connectivity now between you and him, so that he can be your God and you can be his people. Now I'm going to read my verse of scripture. It takes me a long time to get there. Some people start off reading a verse of scripture and go from there. I guess I do it the other way sometimes. Sometimes I never even get to read my verse of scripture. Have you noticed that? But do you know that I've given you a bunch of verses of scripture? Okay. He never opened the Bible once. Yeah, but I quoted all kinds of verses. I probably quoted 30, 40 verses of scripture up to this point. Can he be right? I'm not right, but God's right. God, the Holy Ghost, is right, and he's here. His word is not subjective. He made it so that it is absolutely, it is what it says it is. It doesn't need to be interpreted. In fact, the word of God says it cannot be interpreted. It's not to be privately interpreted. So I just don't even see how you can say that. Well, what was the mother, what was the name of the mother Jesus? That's the way it is. How many stones did Goliath have? Exactly. One. How many, huh? Where did Jesus die?
On the cross.
When did he raise up from the dead? Now people want to try to interpret that, but that'd be wrong. And if you play Bible trivia with anyone who doesn't interpret the scripture, you're losing. Because you're going to sit there and give your interpretation, but on the card there's only one right answer. And it has a verse reference for it. So all this is just a lie. It's just a lie. It's a demonic lie. It's a demonic ploy to keep people from the absolute response that God demands his word, that where we do not live but by the word of God. Jesus there dealing with Satan, dealing with the forces of the hell that would try to destroy him, said, quoted the word, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. Father is going to examine you, he's going to try you, he's going to prove you to see whether or not you're going to live by his word. And then we can just simply say, Father, forgive me every place where I compromised, place I redefined, every place that I self-justified. Self-justification is self-righteousness. That's where we make ourselves right, rather than letting God make us right. We make ourselves right even in the face of an opposition of what God said in his word. What did the Lord tell you to do about relationships around you? Huh? He told you to serve. Huh? He told you to lay down your life. How many of you people do that? Rather the prince and the power of the air makes you instead carry a spirit of offense, feel rejected, feel hurt, feel alienated. You talk rather bad about other people. You create schism, strife, divisions. Are you with me? Evil speakings. Where is that coming from? Prince of power there. God changed your heart so that you could now lay down your life and love people no matter what they do. But that's such, but you don't have to get over in the Holy Ghost to have that realm, to where you just love your enemies. But you get over there And it's so much better than the way you've been living. You don't want to go back to the way you've been living. You hate that. It's so much better yielding to the Holy Spirit and being filled with divine emotions. You don't want to live that way you were living in human emotions anymore. You don't want to live as a mere man anymore because you've been given the divine nature. God lives and walks on the inside of you. He's now filling you with every good thing that He Himself has, and it's coming out of you in explosions of His glory like rivers. Hello? So then you say, how far are we from the truth? Then you say, how far are we from living the life of Christ? Because we've redefined it religiously. When the Word of God opens up the pages and it's beautiful and it's easy, and the Lord Jesus said, Father, I thank you that you hid it from the wise and the prudent and you made it known to the babes. People are not going to take the scripture and redefine it and wrestle it because they don't want to submit to it. If you don't want to submit, what do? You wrestle. You struggle. Just submit. Just say, yes, Lord. I just bow before you. I'm going to let my emotions be ruled by you. I'm going to let my passions be ruled by you. I'm going to let my mind and my thinking. Imagination is your worst enemy. Men would tell you it's your friend. Oh, let the imaginations and the creativity. Nonsense. It's the place where Satan plays. And God tells us to bring into captivity every imagination, to cast it down, to learn to live by the Word. How about these people who were taught to live by the Word? Like Saul before he became Paul. Like Simon the righteous. Like Gamaliel. Others. In that religion, they could not recognize Jesus. And they totally rejected him. And he says, I've come to show you that your deeds are evil and that you are your father, the devil. Well, if they, being, as it were, the most righteous people in the earth, were of the devil, their father the devil, where's all the rest of the world? They lie in wickedness even unto this day. This is the Word of God. Oh, no, we're all children of God. No, you not. You children of another God. You're not children of the only true and living God, the Almighty. You're children of a God called Satan, a self-exalted God. Hello? I'm never going back there. I can't even believe he said that. He can't be right. If he's right, he's going to change my whole perception of people. Yeah, and reality of it is, you may get, the truth may strike your heart and your understanding, and now you have a burden for the lost and dying world who are lay under the stronghold of sin and iniquity, and you'll begin to give all that you have that they might be saved, as Christ Jesus has shown us. Your gods won't be all these other things. The love of ease. Where's the air conditioning? Powder puff my pew, so whatever, you know, so this is not so rough. Baby powder my pew, you know, so bring me a fridge, Lord, bring me a drink from the fridge, Lord Jesus, when you come, because you can't even get up off the couch. I like how Reinhard Bonnke said, there's one thing that God cannot do, get you up off your couch. You got to get up and you got to move. See, if you begin to see things the way that God sees them and you begin to embrace what He said and declared and you'll let the Holy Spirit reveal to you the truth that it is, suddenly your whole appetite, your whole ambition, your whole vision, your whole goal, your whole purpose, your whole insight, everything changes. And now you get His. Now you feel about the world the way He feels about it. Now you have the love that He has. Now you have the compassion that He has. Now your interests are His interests instead of other interests. But so long as everybody, oh, they're not so bad, you know, God's a just God. Yeah, He's a just God, and He hates iniquity, and He's going to cut off the wicked so that they exist no more. So go ahead and continue on with God as a just God, because I know what you're getting ready to say. God is a just God, and we're all going to heaven. No, we're not going to heaven. Jesus is the door. He's the way. He's the truth to life. There is no other access to God, Father, but Him. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth to life, and this way is narrow and is straight. And He says this. Only few people come. The majority of the world rejects what I'm saying, and they're going in a broad way called the road to destruction. I'm just going to agree with Father because I'm going to heaven. I'm not going to hell. And the fact is, the onus upon me to go to heaven, the draw of being in the presence of God and His love and His glory and His beauty is far more impactful than the thought of going to hell and burning in a lake of fire where I gnaw on my tongue for the rest of eternity. Now, that would be impacted on a negative sense. But I am so much more impacted by the beauty of His presence. Hallelujah. Why? Because I let the Holy Ghost have free course in my life. I'm a holy roller. I mean, I've never Yeah, I have rolled on the floor a couple of times, being so caught away in it with the joy. If there was a chandelier, I would swing from it, but I've never done that. I'm a dancer. I dance in the Holy Ghost. I shout. I praise. I run and leap with joy at the moving of the Spirit of the living God in my life. Not just in church, out in the field, out in the workplace. Hallelujah. Never don't know where that's going to begin to erupt and begin to pour out. Because, you know, Paul said, I would that you all speak in tongues. And then he said, I speak in tongues more than y'all. Of course, everybody who wants to give a great exegesis on 1 Corinthians chapter 14 don't even know those two verses of Scripture are actually there. I would that you all speak in tongues, and I speak in tongues more than y'all. And by the way, you're not singing enough in the Holy Ghost when you're in the meeting. And by the way, you're not praying enough in the Holy Ghost when you're in the meeting. What should we do in the meeting? We'll sing in the Holy Ghost, and we'll sing with the understanding also, and we'll pray in the Holy Ghost, and we'll pray with the understanding also. And by the way, that's 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 14 through 16, in case you're looking it up. And the first verses of Scripture that I refer to is verse 7 and verse 16. Are you listening to me? Or is verse 18? I speak in tongues more than you all. And forbid not to speak with tongues. You know why people hate it? Because it's weird. Why is it weird? Because it's heavenly. Why is it heavenly? Because it's the anointing of the Holy Ghost. It's how God birthed the church. Church don't even function outside of it. Church was born in the fire of the Holy Ghost, and if the church, you listen to me. If the church is not expressing, if a church assembly is not expressing the fires of the Holy Ghost, it's not the church. It's another church. If people aren't preaching what Jesus preached, it's another Jesus. By definition, these are the things that we read about in the Bible. Then they were in the first century, that's what Paul was saying. This is what he was saying. Now in the 21st century, is we got it flip-flopped. If you're doing what they were doing in the Bible, then you're weird. And you're not even right. There's something wrong with you guys. See how it's just flip-flopped? Then these signs, this witness, follows them to believe in my name. In my name they cast out devils and they speak with these tongues. Now, it's flip-flop. They not right with God, they're in a cult, there's something wrong, they're heresy, there's something wrong with them because they cast out devils and speak with tongues. It's flip-flopped. Well, it's called apostasy. It's the Antichrist. It's really the heresy. The heresy is literally the Greek word is to have another opinion. Is to have another opinion than that which was expressed and that which is expressed in the Word of God. But we're just all befuddled. Because all these influences. Don't you see how big and influential and powerful the Mormon church is? By most people's reasoning, I don't see why they're not all Mormons. You hear what I'm saying to you? Are you listening to me? Because all of a sudden we make the person who's got the most money and the biggest organization and the biggest group of people, we make them the people who are right. But it's never been that way. It's always been the persecuted. It's always been the minority. It's always been the person that is rejected, that is outside, that is bearing the reproach, that is not accepted, that bears the Word of God. That's right. So we read right here. I'm going to read this to you. I'm trying to. Matthew chapter 5. The Lord says, here, beginning in verse 10, is where I want to start. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness. You walk in righteousness, all that live godly shall suffer persecution. Okay? You're going to walk in righteousness? What are we talking about? A heavenly realm, not religious deeds. Heavenly realm. Manifestation of the Holy Ghost. Person of Jesus. That's what we're talking about. Don't redefine here. You will suffer persecution. He says, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when you shall be reviled, when men shall revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. God's always had the minority. He's always had the persecuted. He's always had those who said, this is God's way. You're not walking in it. Return unto the right way. And they were always persecuted. Go read the list about them as is summarized in Hebrews chapter 11. They were sawn in two. They wandered in wilderness, in desert places, in caves. They were rejected. They were tormented. They were not willing to be spared. Of whom the world was not worthy. You hear me? Yeah. Isaiah is exonerated as one of the great prophets of the Old Testament, but according to history, he was sold sagittally in two. By who? The religious. Not right for you to live. What a cruel punishment. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Do you like the Holy Ghost?
Yes.
Really? He's got us to benanambradai. That's what he's going to do. People say, people want to redefine. They want to make the baptism of the Holy Ghost something else, but the witness of the baptism of the Holy Ghost in the Scripture is the evidence of speaking in tongues. Every place. Every place. And now all of a sudden, somebody come along, some religious people come along that didn't even have the manifestation of the Holy Ghost and try to redefine 1 Corinthians chapter, try to redefine the expression of the Holy Ghost in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 based upon their own opinion, and everybody believed it. And it runs contrary to what's being said. Don't try to tell me. When I sit and listen to people, that I don't care that they have a THD or a BHD. When you're wrong, you're wrong. When you're stupid, you're just stupid. When you say something that defies the evidence that you supposedly are coming to present, come on, that's stupid. You can't talk to me from 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and then defy the very thing that 1 Corinthians chapter 14 is saying. You can't forbid to speak with tongues when the Scripture just said in the very chapter, don't forbid to speak with tongues. Huh? You can't say that everybody can't speak in tongues all at one time when that's how the whole program began, and when 1 Corinthians chapter 14 absolutely says you're not only supposed to speak in tongues at the same time, but you're supposed to sing.
Amen.
Hello.
Amen.
And you're supposed to prophesy too. Oh, well, then you hear all the folks say, oh, well, we're going to prophesy. Yeah, we believe in prophecy. But you don't have any prophecy. Wonder why you don't have any prophecy. Because you grieved the Holy Ghost by not forbidding to speak with tongues. This is why you didn't have prophecy. And you don't have miracles, and you don't have signs and wonders, and you don't have anything more than religion. You don't have the manifest presence of God because you have actually grieved and rejected the one who brings the manifest presence of God, the Holy Ghost. And everything about him is foolishness to the world, and everything about him is a reproach to the world, and everything about him is rejected by the world and persecuted by the world. Just as Mary was persecuted and an outcast because she bore the anointing. She bore the word. Just as Jesus, there was no one persecuted and rejected as much as he was. None. And he's still persecuted to this day among his people because he's all about the Holy Ghost. He's all about heaven being made manifest. You want to get some persecution? Just start moving and get the healing. To start moving the healing of Jesus. You think, well, everybody would be just so blessed if you moved to give the healing. No, they're not going to be so blessed. Because the prince of the power of the atmosphere is going to make you into a liar and a charlatan if you're bringing that anointing that is revealed by Jesus among the religious. Among the religious, not only among the lost, the religious. You hear me?
Yes.
I woke up this morning, I heard in my spirit. The Spirit of the Lord said to me, he said, blessed are you when you're persecuted. He said, embrace persecution. I want you to embrace it. Because if you embrace it, you embrace me. Men will revile you for the kingdom. They will, when you go full in the Holy Ghost, they're not gonna like you. They're gonna reproach you. But you should rejoice. Because the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. What verse of Scripture? Where is that? Does anybody know where that diamond is? That one there is like a That one there is like a 250-carat diamond. No, what's the biggest diamond ever? Is it like 250, something like that? That's bigger. You know what? Because you know where your diamonds are. You know where your riches are. You know where your treasures are, right? And when you got that treasure, I mean, everybody should have that treasure, right? Everybody should know 1 Peter 4:14. Otherwise, tell me, you know, I don't want to, don't you try to tell me what the Bible says. Don't you even, just obey. Because you don't even know the Word of God. You don't know it enough. You don't know enough to pass my test. You're listening to me. I'm gonna throw the eraser at you. No, I'm not. I'm just giving you the old fisheye to say, come on, give me a break. It is amazing to me how many people try to tell me what the Bible says and they don't even know the word. You know, they've never read the Bible through one time, much less a continual reading of the word. Neither have they really ever given themselves to a continuous study like they did to history or math or, you know, whatever. Can you hear me? I want to threaten you just a little bit here, so excuse me while I do it and put you in your place. And I know I'm not talking to anybody in here. I'm sure I'm talking to somebody on the web or on YouTube right now. Did you sit there and try to tell me, Mr. Know-it-all, about how what God did when he laid the foundation of the earth, and you don't even know what 1 Peter 4:14 is, which is a treasure. See, the Word of God will keep you. See, if you let the Word of God dwell in you, you know, you let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly, that's what God tells us to do. Then when these things begin to happen, you get excited. You get to rejoice. Rejoice when men reject you and speak behind closed doors about you and tell you why they don't want to come to your meeting. They don't want to come to my meeting because the Antichrist spirit, because the spirit of the devil absolutely wants to keep them, the God of this world wants to keep them from an encounter with Jesus. And I got an encounter with Jesus. Why? Because I'm going to cooperate with the Holy Ghost. Not because I'm any person, but because I'm going to obey God. I'm going to go with the Word of God and the Spirit of God. And I'm going to be a part of the Holy Spirit being communicated to people. And people have an encounter with God. I just think the people looking at me kind of oddball-like on 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 14, you ought to turn, open up your Bibles and read it. And see if it's even underlined in your Bible. It is? Everything's underlined in your Bible. She's telling me that it's underlined in her Bible. But look, that doesn't even count. Everything's underlined in her Bible. And that's good. Every word of God is perfect, isn't it? Huh? Some people are wondering, is it? Look at it in your Bible. Huh? Some people might say, what is a Bible? Exactly. It is the Word of God that's been watched over. What a blessing. Ain't nobody has this without the mercy and the grace of God. You so blessed today when you can say that Jesus Christ is your ruler? Huh? Nobody can say that Jesus Christ is my master, my ruler, but by the Holy Ghost. People can say that Jesus Christ is this and different modern ideas of Jesus Christ is my religious figurehead. Because I think that that is really the definition of what people say when they say Jesus Christ is Lord. They don't mean Jesus Christ is my sovereign ruler, my master. I don't do anything unless he tells me to. Because that's what that word means in that context. Exegetically, what it was saying to the people of the day and the time, we don't understand about what it meant to be slaves. They were lived in that period of time. He is my sovereign ruler, my master. I don't do anything unless he tells me to do it. I don't move unless he tells me to move. Nobody can say that but by the Holy Ghost. Can you say that? Can you say that?
Yes.
That by the power of the Holy Ghost, he's your sovereign ruler, your master. You don't do anything unless he gives you permission. That was like a yes and amen on the weakest level. Huh? If I would have said, how many of you are for, you know, your favorite football team? I hope it wouldn't be a roar. Are you so caught up in the spirit of this world? Or your favorite whoever? Your favorite movie star or whatever? Roar. Your favorite, you know, musician. What used to be the court jest, now we've idolized as demigods. We're a weird society. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Testing. 1, 2, 3. I'm trying to push every button, flip every switch. I'm trying to hit everything here this morning. I want to leave you helplessly stripped of all false securities and feeling terrible about the things you've been doing outside of God. So that now you can come and cleave unto him.
Amen.
So that you can understand, I could do nothing without him. I'm like, can you just begin to think about this when you start getting all excited about some wisdom in this world, some genius in this world, huh? Some Stephen Hawking in this world, and the Lord says, the wisdom of man is foolishness to me. I'm going to be on his side. I'm going to go, that's foolishness. Rather than being on the world side going, looking at the Holy Ghost, the manifestation of the Holy Ghost, that's weird. There's something wrong with that. Yeah, there's something wrong with it. Because you're listening to the Spirit that is contrary to it, that hates it, wants to kill it. You hear me?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Ha ha. Praise the name of Jesus. So I just wanted all of you to just give yourself over to the Lord. Understand that you're in the right place when you're being persecuted and reproached and rejected and you don't fit in. I want you to just get excited about that. I want you to feel blessed. I don't want you to feel bad. And when somebody starts telling you about how you don't agree with the manifestation of the Holy Ghost, especially tongues, just look at them and say, you don't know what you're missing. You're missing the means by which you're built up in your most holy faith. You're missing out on the means by which love is established on the inside of you and God's able to take over all of your emotions and all of your passions. You're missing out on the means by which God is able to strengthen you and mature you in the faith so that you can begin to manifest in that life of Jesus Christ in a demonstration of power. Paul said, I fully preached the gospel. He preached it. He spoke in tongues more than them all. And he said, I fully preached the gospel with mighty signs and wonders, with the demonstration and the power of the Holy Ghost, so that the full gospel is preached. That's all I want. You can't have that unless you're willing to give yourself over to what this world would call ridiculous, weird, strange. It's not a denominational bias. I think denominationalism is just as bad as any other form of a religion. It's the Word of God. Somebody says your denomination. That's the Word of God. It's just Bible. It's just the Bible. Don't try to categorize it so you can feel better. Don't build a wall around yourself so that you can feel better about your lies and your deception and your falsehood. Try to make something God's word that's not His word. You hear what I'm telling you? Yeah. I want to get you because I want the Holy Ghost to be able to take over your life, have free course to you. I want you to be able to say, according to Jesus, what Jesus said, out of your innermost being, out of your kalia, which is a Greek word, a Greek terminology, forgive me, that is used to express the passions and emotions of men. He's used a very unique word there, out of your kalia, out of your passions and your emotions. It's the way it's used in Attic Greek. You can go and verify. Just type it in. Those of you on the web right now and watching, just Google it. You can find out. Homer. Of course, you have to read Greek, right? Okay, forget about that. But at any rate, out of your kalia should flow rivers of the expressions of God. Rivers of the Holy Ghost. So you have to ask yourself, I'm a little drunk right now in the Holy Ghost. You have to ask yourself this question. When's the last time you had an eruption? Huh? When's the last time you had quantifiable rivers of expressions of God's glory? You're going to have to learn how to yield the Holy Ghost. It's not about getting God to do something. It's about receiving what He's given. To receive what He's given, you're going to have to meet the conditions of His word. You're going to have to agree with them. Two cannot walk together unless they agree. But Jesus said, you take what I have to give you. Here's the proof that you have what I'm talking about. You'll have inexhaustible expressions. You'll have the life of God. You will have the expressions of the Holy Ghost. He says it just like this. Out of your passions and emotions. Out of your kalia. Because you don't know what belly is. You know what I'm saying? He just take a little word and they just set aside. Well, I don't think I know what that is. Out of your passions and your emotions should flow rivers of living water. This spake he of the Holy Ghost, which was not yet given, for he was not yet glorified. But when he was glorified, Peter said in Acts chapter 2 and verse 33, Jesus being glorified and exalted at the right hand of God has poured forth that which you see and hear, and what they saw and heard, was coming up out of them with inexhaustible expressions. Huh? And if I stood here for very long, I'd lose the ability to speak in the English language. In fact, I can speak better in tongues than I can in English right now. That's why it sounds all slurry. But that sounds very articulate, doesn't it? Yeah. Hallelujah. Not a slur in it. And out of that is where we prophesy. And out of that is where we move in gifts of healing. And out of that is where we move in miracles. And out of that is where we move in the demonstration of the Holy Ghost. We excel out of that in the realms of faith and increase in faith to where even mountains have to obey. Out of that is where love rises up to express Father's love. Amen. I'm going to read this verse of scripture to you, then I'm going to close. Okay? Because I just want you to know where your riches are. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 14, you looking at that? I want you to get excited about people not liking you. Huh? Paul said, if we sought to please men, we would not please God. Do you hear that?
Yeah.
Look, Paul made a definition. If you're a man pleaser, you're not a God pleaser. He said, if we sought to please men, we would not please God. You just have to understand. Put yourself in that. Well, I'm just trying to get along with everybody. Not me. I want to love everybody like the Lord, like Father loved. God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son. And He looks to us, He said, will you so love the world with me that you'll lay down your life? That you go and do everything you possibly can do? You'll give it all? That you might save one? That you might be used by me to reach just even one soul? And I'll tell you right now, believe me, the harvest is great. Harvest is plenteous, laborers are few. You know, I've thought about just going, throwing myself in the big middle of, because there's over 500 million orphans. I've thought about just going, throwing myself in the big middle of, you know, as many orphans as I could handle. You know, just because I could do it. I go out there, I can farm, I can animal husbandry, I can create a food supply and no problem in no time. I'll take care of them. I mean, you know, I'd have a threshold, probably around 100, maybe 200, not receiving any income or money from anybody else, just doing with what I have. Because every one of them would make heaven. I'd raise them, everyone, just like I raise my kids, they'd all make heaven. They'd hate the world and love God. They wouldn't fit in the world at all. We'll look at it and go, you awkward. Yep, that's us. Awkward. All excited about heaven. You'll see us happy about heaven. Sad about the things you're happy about, and I know where it's awkward. I mean, we got to be in that. I mean, for me, what I'm doing is I'm just saying, you know what? Father, use me to be able to do beyond, way beyond all of that. Use me to do something that then continues to go on after I've left. Because I don't want to just, I'm not going to go 100. I can't go 100. Thousands a week. Tens of thousands of making me feel better. But what is that, percentage-wise, if there's 500 million orphans and all of them could be reached? All of them could be reached. Not counting old people. And the population of 3 billion people that have never heard the gospel, there's so many old people, and they're just not taken care of. You go take care of the orphans and the widows, the old people. Every one of them make heaven. If there was a person leading them in the right way. Are you with me?
Yes.
Well, you come over in this Holy Ghost realm. It's Jesus' realm. Amen. And that's going to become your vision. That's going to become your passion. Because it's Papa's passion. Your heart be made one with His. Amen. And that Amoserena. And that Amoserena will just take you into a deeper depth of that expression and of that glory. Because there's a greater yieldedness, a greater receptivity of that which He's already given. People acting, you know, praying faithless prayer, acting like God's got to give it, as though He's restrained and He's holding it back. No, He's poured out His Spirit upon all flesh, like the water that covers the sea. Hallelujah. In abundance. It's just that people don't know how to receive because they've got another philosophy. They've taken, you take the Word of God, you mix it with any idea of men, and you've got philosophy. You hear me?
Yes.
You listen to me. I can show you over and again where that's been done in history. One of the people that, four of the people that people call church fathers, they're not my father, they're not my church father, but people like Justin Martyr, Tatian, Alexander, I mean Clement of Alexandria, Origen, Clement of Alexandria said this. He said, the Word of God is, I quote, the Word of God by itself is of very little value. It must be interpreted through the robes of the philosopher to be understood. And that's people's church father. The Word of God by itself is of very little value. It must be interpreted through the robes of the philosopher to be understood. Oh yeah, that's what most people believe. That's what's distilled. It's not go to the Word of God. It's go to your little planner, your little Bible, your little book about the Bible. And then hear what God has to say. Throw that book, burn that book. Open the Bible. Your heart needs to be hungry for the Word of God. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Testing, 1, 2, 3. Listen to this. Hallelujah. It's hard to break in here. But I'm going to start verse 13 because I can't start at verse 14.
It's the whole chapter is good. This whole book is good. This whole epistle is good. This chapter, I love this chapter, the way it starts off. And helps us to understand really how that when we've suffered with the Lord Jesus Christ, we've ceased from sin. And we understand that in the context of what I've been talking about, living in the heavenly realm and being rejected by men. Because you just live over in the Holy Ghost realm. But I'm not going to go in that. I'm not back all the way at the first verse. It's just that I just love First Epistle of Peter. I love like First Epistle of Peter like I love Second Epistle of Peter. Kind of like I love the First Epistle of John, and Third and Second. And kind of like I love the whole Bible. Okay. I pray that you do the same. I pray that the Word of God, I pray that I can be used of the Holy Spirit to whet your appetite for how tasty the Word of God is, how delightful it is. I pray, if I can't do that, that I'll be so salty to you, you got to get a drink of water. You hear me? And I'm talking about the drink of the Holy Ghost. Amen. This is just too much for me. Holy Spirit, come help me, kind of thing. But rejoice in as much as you are partakers of Christ's suffering. And you got to connect that to the first part of the verse that talks about ceasing from sin because you're so caught up in glory. But nonetheless, I'm not going to go into that now. Otherwise, I'm going to preach another two-hour message. But rejoice in that you, hallelujah. Praise God for his goodness. I tell you, I'm being stirred with all kinds of holy emotions. I could actually feel like I'm being translated at this moment in time. If I disappear, don't worry, I'll be back. I've been practicing translation because I think it's a very good missions program. I just love the, don't you just love the joy? Don't you just love the peace? Don't you love the glory? Don't you love, I mean, people don't realize this. If I come over here and I take this this electrical receptacle here and I open it up and expose the wires and I get you to come over here and grab two certain wires, you're going to get a jolt. You're going to whoo. You're going to first look at me because you already know. You're going to get shocked and you're not know if you're ready for this. When you come to church, you ought to be ready to get shocked. Because people want to make an experience with God less than an experience with a little bit of electricity. And that ain't even close to the jolts you get from heaven. So don't think it weird when all of a sudden you see me start getting jolted. But the glory of God. People want to make an encounter with God less than an encounter with their dog. No, I'm not kidding you, right? Because I see the love affection going on between a person and their dog. You know what? It just doesn't seem like there's that much going on between them and Jesus in the meeting. But but it even goes bigger than that. It's bigger than that encounter. Oh, because the Spirit of the Lord comes and does things on the inside of us that are bigger than anything that he could do on the outside, as it were. I mean, Moses had something big happen to him when the Lord passed over him. And he was able to look up and see Father, and he saw him from his waist up as the appearance of a man and from his waist down. As the Lord put his hand over him, covered him, and shouted out his name as he passed by. That was an experience. It was such an experience that Moses' face lit up and glowed with a lethal glow of light. So that they had to veil him because they couldn't see it. It overwhelmed them. And Paul said they had to veil him because they couldn't look into the new covenant, which you and I are supposed to be living in. Somebody said to me one time, man of God said to me one time, he says, so, Pastor, do you think that we've missed sections of the Bible? I said, we've missed whole chapters, brother. We don't just miss sections. We've missed whole chapters. And then we want to miss whole chapters and we want to redefine God's word and say, Father, come baptize it with your glory. Come and express all the glory and all the beauty and all the splendor of who you are in the context of my unbelief, in the context of my changing your word. He's not going to do it. Noah's boat would not float. God's boat floated. So he had to just do it just like God designed it. Moses' tabernacle would never be filled with the glory of God. So he had to take heed that he built it just exactly like Father said. And now we live in a greater glory in the ministry of righteousness. How much more must we take heed unto the word of God?
not to alter it, not to change it. The Lord says it like this. He said, if you alter or change it, he said, if you add to it, these plagues shall be added to you. And if you take away from it, your name will be taken out of the book of life. Why? Because to add to it or take away from it is to ultimately compromise with deception, and you're going to ultimately be ruined. You say, well, isn't there a little bit of room for interpretation? No. It means exactly what it says. All that's going to happen is that you're going to get revelation as you obey. That's big different from revelation, big difference from interpretation. Revelation is where the meaning's always there, but now it hits you. You knew that on the third day he was raised from the dead, but you get yourself a revelation of it. You get yourself a revelation of his resurrection, and it's as though you were actually there. Do you understand?
Yes.
I want you to be changed today. God is not pleased with anybody staying the same. God demands growth. God demands maturity. God demands fruit. He has not changed. He looked at Israel and he said, because you barren and fruitless, the kingdom of God is taken from you this day and is given to another nation to bring forth the fruits thereof. You think he's changed his mind? You think he's going to act different about us? Somebody told me that God now has modified his judgments. Man could never meet up to his judgments, so that Jesus Christ came and canceled his judgments, that he modified them so that he could feel better about man. God's never changed his judgments. Judgments are just the same. He sent Jesus Christ so that you and I could be made, recreated again in his image and his likeness, even as he created man in his image and his likeness, and man was polluted and distorted and twisted by the likeness of Satan because of sin. God sent forth his righteous judgments in Christ Jesus, condemned sin in the flesh, that we might now live in the Spirit. We might now live in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, I want to read this verse of Scripture to you. I don't want to stop, because I figure I could take you on over into exceeding joy. I figure I could take you on over in the Word of God if I could get you to obey. Then you begin to experience joy unspeakable and full of glory. Then you begin to experience the river flow out of your belly. Huh. Oh, no, well, we're just going to have a relationship with God without all that. Well, you don't have a relationship with God. You got another religion. No different from Hinduism. No different from Buddhism. No different from any other ism. Just religion. For it's far more deceptive, for it's now labeled Christian. And if that light that is in you be darkness, well, how great is that darkness? Christian religion, the most deceptive religion on the planet. I can easily reach a Hindu by the whole power of the Holy Ghost. I can't easily reach a Christian by the power of the Holy Ghost. Because as Paul said, and as Isaiah said, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost. Uh-oh. Then you better make sure that you don't think that you're an exemption or an exception. And you better make sure that you humble yourself before under the mighty hand of God and start saying, Lord, I don't want to resist you or reject you. I want to understand how to develop a great sensitivity towards you, lest I should be those people that always resist the Holy Ghost. While I'm, you know, being approved of by a man, while I'm in the company of everybody who believes what I believe, and we all just so, you know, high on agreement as you oppose God, the Holy Ghost. Watch out. Calling you back. He said, but rejoice in as much as you are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when the glory shall be revealed, you may be glad with exceeding joy. And he's talking about a future glory, huh? But then watch how he's going to talk about now, a present glory. Are you ready? He says, if ye be reproached for the name of Christ, and once again, that's the anointing, that's his presence, that's his person. See, Jesus is here walking among us, that God would not abhor us. Leviticus chapter 26 and verse 12. Hallelujah. I shall shut my tabernacle in the midst of you that I may not abhor you, and you shall be my people and I shall be your God. Huh? Huh? He has put his tabernacle in the midst of us, and in fact, he made us his tabernacle. That he come and live in us and walk in us and move in us. Hallelujah. And have a proof and a demonstration that it's true. He says to us, if ye be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the spirit of glory and God rest upon you. Huh? That's why I like, bless, come on, go ahead, reproach me, revile me, persecute me. Come on, bless me. Because I know exactly what's going to happen as soon as people start, and especially the more your life is threatened in it. Because some of you just, sticks and stones should break my bones. Because that's the way the people live it, right? They won't break your bones, right? But people live as though it's just like sticks and stones, right? They could take offense. But how about when you get persecuted and your life is really on the line? They tell you if you come up here, we're going to kill you. Huh? Or they just don't allow you to be around them anymore. They snarl at you. They won't look at you or touch you anymore like they did Mary. So they even, many years later, they say to Jesus, John chapter 8, we were not born of fornication. Basically the implication, like you. Our father is Abraham. Jesus said, God is able to raise up these sons unto Abraham from these rocks. He is radical, isn't he? You would never win the argument with Jesus. Are you willing to come out and bear the reproach? To suffer outside the camp? Not in the camp. Jesus said, what is that? Hebrews 13:13. Is that what it is? Hebrews 13:13. He says, come on out. You're in the camp. Everybody's feeling great about each other and talking about how wonderful we are with the people of God. He says, come on out. I'm out here all by myself. Come out here. Come outside the camp and suffer the reproaches. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Lord, there's nothing so sweet, so wonderful as those things that you've freely given us in Christ Jesus. And just thank you so much for them. Father, I ask you to forgive those who speak evil against the Holy Spirit, who speak evil against his expressions, these divine expressions of your glory that you've used and that you use to grow us and mature us and develop us so that we don't act like humans under the atmosphere of the God of this world, as those who've been trained and brought up, shaped and formed in sin and iniquity. But now as those who are born of you, alive from the dead, and being taught and formed by the workings and the operation of the Holy Ghost, Lord, it's so wonderful and so beautiful. Father, forgive these people, for they know not what they do. They don't know what they say. For they have been misled by those religious leaders who've not known you, but presented themselves as though they did. And they did not understand, oh God, that they would have been able to identify false shepherds. They had been able to identify false prophets because they did not speak according to your word and make those things which you have forever settled in heaven as valid and as real today as they've ever been, for your word will not pass away. And we know, God, that we live in the time that you poured out your spirit upon all flesh, and just as you did it in the beginning, so you do it to continue to do it in the same way even unto this day. And we know, God, that it is your purpose that it would come forth even in greater expressions so that we may begin to move in the authority of heaven. Oh, so much so that we do not only your works, but even greater works. And Lord, we thank you right now, Father, that there will be a hungry and a thirsty people that will be so desperate to be taught of you, to be taught by you, Holy Ghost, that there won't be any resistance anymore, that there won't be any more saying no to you and being somehow reproached by you, but everybody be captivated by you. Hallelujah. Just stand with me. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Next time you begin to hear a voice say, don't let the Holy Ghost begin to speak through you in tongues and prophecy, just recognize that God's not God, the Holy Ghost. Because in that reasoning is, oh, well, they won't understand. No, God said that tongues is a sign for the unbeliever. Didn't say the tongues is a sign for the believer. The tongues is a sign for, well, we don't want to offend the unbeliever. No, you don't want to offend the believer. It's your problem. It is a sign for the unbeliever. What is that beautiful language that you're speaking? What is that beautiful glory that is being expressed through you as the life of Christ is made manifest with such joy, with such love, with such faithfulness, with such compassion? Be the defender of all those who are absent. Always just interceding, never accusing. Huh? Always holding up, never tearing down. Huh? Hallelujah. Always being a defense instead of an adversary. Hallelujah. Today, Jesus is calling you. Christ Jesus. He's God and there is no God beside Him. He's the one that came upon this earth and said, I am God. I'm it and the only one. No other person in any other religion ever said that. Now, there were kings that said that. Some of the Sargon kings of Assyria said, I am, but they didn't make themselves God of the whole world because they didn't want to offend other gods. They just say, I am God of Akkad. Parts of ancient Mesopotamia or other things of that nature. Or I am the divine God of Egypt. They just kept it territorial so they didn't get messed up, get sideways with some other god they didn't know anything about. Jesus come along and said, I'm it. There is none beside me. And you are lost forever, hopelessly lost in darkness under the tyranny of one called Satan. And I'm here to set you free. And all you have to do is call upon my name. I'm not going to force you. I'm not going to demand you. I'm not going to reign over you like the powers of darkness. But if you should call upon my name, if you just call out for my help. Well, that's what that means. You say, you recognize you're in sin and you're in iniquity. And you say, I need some help. I want to get rid of this. I want out of it. People want religion. Listen to me. The Lord is only here to help people who want to be delivered from sin and darkness. He's not here to help people who want to be religious. Hello. This is hard for people to hear. I'm telling you right now, I'm sure I'm just talking once again to people on the web or watching online or the YouTube. Surely I can't be talking to anybody in here. God is not interested in half measures. He wants you to be born again. He wants you to be a brand new creation because nothing about you is acceptable to Him. It's all marred by demonic power and under the authority of demonic power. And the Lord says if there's anybody who wants to escape, men sit in darkness. And gross darkness is over them. But now the light has sprung up. The glorious wellspring of heaven, the light has come and now stands in the midst of those who sit in darkness and under the shadow of death. But here's the sad reality. Men love darkness rather than light because they love evil. This is the way it comes down. You have to ask yourself, do you love evil? Do you love sin? Do you justify evil? Do you justify sin? If you do, God's giving you the privilege to go with that pack, to run with that herd, to run with that, the masses. Broad is the way that leads to destruction. Narrow. And the Lord Jesus, He used the word, He said, straight is the gate. He says, narrow is the entryway. It's like coming up to a great wall that reaches unto heaven and expands the whole of the universe. And there's one little slit that you've got to kind of slide through. That's all, the only entryway in. He says, literally, agonize to enter in. Be desperate. Be so overwhelmed. Oh God, I'd do anything to get in. Agonize to enter into the straight gate. To come into the race of life. He says, because there are many that are without. People are going to come up. They'll come up. Many are called, few come in, few are chosen. They'll come up and they'll stand at the gate and they make a religion around the gate. Jesus is the gate. He's the door, He's the way in. Right over here He is. And they'll talk about all that He did, but they never go into His realm. They never enter into heaven. They never enter into the realms of the Holy Ghost. As many as are led by the Spirit, they're the sons of God. If you walk in the Spirit, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. If you are alive, made alive by the Spirit, also live in Him. They never go to that. They live a human realm. They live in a human realm. You live in a human existence and say, well, you know, I believed on the name of Jesus. Have you believed on the name of Jesus to the point that you have been converted and become a new creation? That God, His life and person fills you, and that your desires have become His desires, and you love His word, and His, you have a hunger and a thirst for the things of the Spirit, now that you may grow in grace. You listen to me as a newborn babe. Because religion has come and messed up the whole message. We constantly have to say, wait a minute. So long as you live for yourself, you're not living for God. Because people want to make it different. They redefine it different from Jesus. God's calling you. He says, you want to escape from the system of this world. Do you want to escape from the prince of the power of the air? Do you want to no longer live like the rest of human beings live? Do you now want to live in the realms of which I have presented to you? The realms of the Holy Ghost, the realms of the Spirit. The realms of the heaven. So Paul said, our citizenship is in heaven. Our conversation and conduct of our life is in heaven. We seated in the heavenly realm. Understand? This is why I want people to every day continually read the Bible in a way that it doesn't take them 50 years to get through the Bible. Because if you'll read the Word of God will correct you. But people don't read the Bible. They just listen to what everybody has to say about the Bible, and they're now deceived. But if you would read the Bible, if you just systematically read the Bible, start at Genesis 1:1 and read Revelation 22:21, then come back, start at Genesis 1:1, read through to Revelation 22, and then come back. Somebody said, that sounds terrible, laborious, oh my. No. The third time it's going to start getting better. Before long, you're going to have an appetite for it, and you're going to go, this is the best thing that's ever happened in my life, having the Word of God continually in my life. Because now the Lord corrects you. The Word of God comes up and corrects you. You go, wait a minute, look at what it just says right here. The preacher was wrong. Eureka. Lo and behold, revelation has come. Let God's word be true. And every man be a liar, including me. If I speak anything that is contrary to the word, Isaiah said, if anybody declares anything that is contrary to the word, it is proof that there is no light in them. John said, if anybody says they know the Lord and walks in sin, they're a liar. So you're going to redefine that? You're going to make it different so you can feel better about yourself and your group? Or are you going to surrender and say, cry out to God, lay hold upon the mercy of God and say, Father, change me. I want to get this right. I don't want to be a religious person who always resists the Holy Ghost. I don't want to be a follower of men's religion. I want to be a follower of you, Christ Jesus. Because you people, you just need to get it right. Religion, popular religion does not deliver the Word of God. Does not. And that is not saying some kind of self-promoting, subjective declaration. The evidence, I rather say, so that people can understand it in modern vernacular, the data is clear. I had a mentor in science. He said to me, Mark, don't get emotional about your data. Let it do the talking. Just put it out there and say, here are the conclusions. Here's the confidence intervals. Here's what we did. There's the results. Let it do the talking and then just say nothing else. Just stand back. Let everybody ask the questions they want. Let everybody do whatever they need to do. But you can't make it different than what it is. The Word of God is far greater evidence than just data. Because that's data by definition is the analysis of men. And through analysis of men through interpretive skills. This is the Word of God. It's come to try every person's life. Come to try every person's life. It's the means by which you and I are born again. It's the means by which we're saved. Now, let me just take another place. Christ Jesus is the living Word of God. And there's no difference between Him and the Word that's written on the pages of the Bible. No difference. You listen to me. No difference. And that is by the highest authority that exists. That's by the authority of God Himself. It's not by some THD from, or PhD from Harvard or Yale. Listen to me. And this knows no denominational barriers. Don't you think I'm just picking on denomination? I'm talking about people stuck in denominationalism, interpreting the Bible. See what other people said? I mean, I love telling this story because I think it's so impactful. Is when I was invited to come and do a conference for Voice of the Martyr in Alexandria, Egypt. And they said, please, Mark, don't, when you come, we want you to talk about the kingdom of God, but we don't want you to flow in the Holy Ghost because there's every denomination is going to be there. The Coptics are going to be there. The Methodist is going to be there. The Episcopalian, the Pentecostal, the Presbyterian. So I said, you know, I went, God, I said, look, I won't do anything. I just preach on the kingdom of God. Let Father do it. Father did it. And I was so blessed by the Jesuit priest who came and said, and the Jesuits are the academicians of the Catholic, the Roman Catholic Church. They came to me, and this is what they said. We're so glad that Mark has returned to Egypt because Mark is the patron saint of Egypt. Why? Because they responded to the Holy Ghost. Somehow, they had moved past the religious bias that had been imposed upon them, and they could see the anointing. They could see the glory. They could hear the Word of God. The Word of God is the Word of God. You can't change it. What you should want is to conform to it. Today, if you've been reluctant to conform to the Word of God, if you've been willing to listen and be followers of men rather than Christ Jesus and the Holy Ghost, repent. Call upon the name of the Lord. He'll deliver you from religion as much as he'll deliver you from sin. Both are mastered by a man, an angel called Satan, and mastered by men who are under his influence. And they're found in every denomination, every religion that exists upon the face of the earth. Planted there to deceive men. Demonic assignments to deceive men. Today Jesus is calling. She said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Jesus said, I personify the truth. He said, the whole world lies in wickedness. The whole world lies under the deception and under the lie of Satan. I'm the door into the room of life. Would you come in? He said, I'll send you the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of truth. He'll lead you and guide you into all truth. I was preaching a Bible class in a scientific institution for anybody who wanted to know about the Lord, and a couple of guys came. And I was ministering by the Spirit of the Lord, and all of them knew it. They knew enough about the anointing to recognize I was ministering by the Spirit of the Lord. And one of them, who was a lay preacher, said, well, you know, we all have parts of the truth. I said, yeah, well, let's go look at that in the verse of Scripture over here in John 16. And I shall send you the Holy Ghost, and he shall lead and guide you into parts of the truth. Isn't that amazing? So why would you speak a lie? Why would you speak something that's not part of the evidence? He said, I'll send you the Holy Ghost, and he'll lead you and guide you into all truth, not parts of the truth. Huh? Oh, we all got some little part of it. We're all like a bunch of blindfolded people, and we're all standing in front of an elephant. Somebody's got the trunk, and they're saying that God's like the trunk. Somebody's got the tail, and they're saying God's like the tail. And somebody's got the leg, and somebody's got the ear. And if you take them and put them all together, you got God. No, you don't. You got the imaginations of men. Blinded men. And if you follow the blind, where will you end up? What a terrible analogy to try to help people understand how we're supposed to be more tolerant and acceptance of everybody's opinion and insight. I'm not tolerant and acceptance of my own insight. I learned very early in an educational system, the one thing that I learned is that your emotions will bias you to the data and to the evidence. Your personal ideas will skew the observation before your eyes. And then there's ways to prove that. That helped me. That helps me that much more. And say, I'm living by the Word of God and His Word alone. If He said, I don't care if I understand it or not, I'm going to do it. I'm going to say yes. Because He's come to give us wisdom that goes beyond anything that men can know out of their own intellect. Amen. out of their own schools. Today, we're calling you over to a place of surrender. There's people out here today, you've never been born again. You've never been born of the Spirit. You're not alive to God, you're dead. Even though you live, you're dead. You're dead to Him. You cut off from Him. He does not acknowledge your existence in that way of saying that you have life. Because the Scripture said, he that has the Son, possesses the Son, has life. He that does not possess or have the Son does not have life. That's God's definition. He acknowledged you as dead already. And He says, I've come to give you life. He's not condemning anyone. He's just telling everybody what it is. So I thought you're condemning. No, it's telling you what your state is that you might have. You know, if you just said, this is your state, and said, poor you, then that would be condemning. But to say, this is your state, but here's an opportunity now for you to live. No. That's loving. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Today, just turn you. Today, I don't care who you are, where you are from, what you know. Why don't you just turn your life completely over to Jesus and recognize the Father's purpose that everything about your life be different? And you say, you mean everything? I mean, isn't there some things about me that he likes? No. Not if you've yet to encounter Jesus. And then, when you become acceptable to God through Christ Jesus, acceptable, truly acceptable, then He wants you to grow. And He wants you to be conformed in every way to the very image of Christ Jesus, who is the life. He wants you to live the life. The Lord isn't interested in getting you inducted into religion. He's calling you right now. All you have to do is respond to Him with your heart and say, okay, Lord Jesus, I want out of this thing. I want out of the death. I want out of the darkness. I no longer want to be conformed to man. I want to be conformed to you. Come deliver me. Come, Holy Spirit, lead me. Come, Holy Spirit, take full control of my life. I'm not going to put restrictions or restraints upon you. And He'll come and fill you right now. Jesus is calling you. He makes it real simple. All you have to do is cry out for help. Come help me, Lord. I want to be delivered out of this. I want to walk with you. I want to be yours. I don't want to be Satan's anymore. Because that's the choice. You're either going to be under the stronghold of Satan, loving your sin that you like. Somebody said, well, I'm not so bad. Compared to who? Well, I try to do good. Compared to who? Because there's no comparison but Jesus. So right now, just accept the Word of God as being an accurate description of things. Yield yourself to Christ Jesus and let Him change you right now. Let the power of the Holy Ghost come upon you and He'll create a new creation. He'll create a new heart, a new desire, a new passion, a new outlook. Your heart will be united with Father. You'll love like Him. You'll have compassion for the lost like Him. He'll change everything about your life. You'll love righteousness and learn to love it. Hallelujah. And you'll hate iniquity. And learn to hate it even more. Yes. Amen. Anyone today, Jesus is standing at the door of your heart. He's knocking. He just simply says, if any man will open up the door, I'll come in. He says it to you today like He said it to Mary. He said, the power of the Most High shall come upon you and overshadow you. And that holy thing that should be conceived on the inside of you by the Holy Ghost should be called a new creation, a new heart, a new spirit. Father, thank you so much that you wrote our names in the book of life. Thank you, Father, that through the blood of Jesus, your only begotten Son, you've washed away every stain of sin. You removed it far from us, as far as the east is from the west. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, that you sent the Holy Spirit. You created within us a new heart and a new spirit. You brought forth a new creation, created after your own image and after your own likeness, so that we may in every way love the things that you love and hate the things that you hate and agree with you. Thank you, Father, for this life, this abundant life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Let the Spirit come upon you. Receive the Holy Ghost. Just let the Spirit of the Lord touch you right now. Let Him overwhelm you with His goodness. I break every mind-blinding spirit in the name of Jesus. I break every stronghold and every lie of Satan that would hold its sway over the minds and thoughts and thinking of men. I set you free right now in Jesus' name, that you may know the truth, and the truth may make you free. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, every sickness and every disease, I command it to depart out of your body and leave you in Jesus' name. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, receive the Holy Ghost and be overwhelmed with the goodness of God's glory, and let His presence fill your soul and your spirit in every dimension of your life from this day forward. Hallelujah. Well, amen. Come worship the Lord. Come worship the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings. Find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in the name of Jesus. If there's anybody here you want prayer for anything, come, we'll pray with you and for you. Doesn't matter who you are, just understand this. Christ died for you. Christ Jesus, He died for you. And He calls you to come live in Him. Don't turn away. 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 Don't turn away from Him. Don't turn away. Jesus is calling. Your time is running out. He would say, when is the end of the world? Don't worry about when the end of the world is going to come. Worry about when the end of your life is going to come. More than likely, the end of your life will come before the end of the world. And at the end of your life, it will be the end of the world for you. You better get ready and you better prepare yourself to stand before the living God, to meet your God. Oh, today we plead with you. We cry out to you that in Jesus' name you respond to Him. You turn your heart towards Him. Don't think that you're going to leave this meeting and be able to continue the way that you've been living and be right with God. Because once the Word of God has been delivered to you, you have a responsibility before Him. Yeah, there's more than 3 billion people that have never heard. You want to sit around and talk about whether or not what responsibility they have towards God. That's an entirely different subject, which the Bible fully addresses. The issue is, how about you? What are you going to do with the Word of God? What are you going to do? How are you going to respond to this life?